Pritish Kamath on the Axioms of Choice.
Yeah, so we start with this famous picture which you may have already seen, but we'll come back to it later in the talk. So I intended to this talk to be a popular talk, so and I expected a larger crowd. So you know, Stephen Hawking said that you lose half the viewers for every mathematical statement. So I would not use any mathematical notation throughout the talk, but I will still, use rigor without notation. And a guide to good presentation says that no slide should contain more than one sentence. So, and ideally it should not contain any. So, although I couldn't, completely implement this, but I have done it partially, and you can pardon this contradiction. Yeah, so this is the brief overview. First I will talk about what is an axiom. And then I will describe what is an axiom of choice. And then I will describe one puzzle which you may have already seen. And then there is a small extension of that puzzle which apparently does not seem to have a solution. But if you assume the axiom of choice, there is a solution. So we'll see that later. So what is an axiom? Oxford Dictionary defines axiom as a statement that is true, true, it's self-evidently true. That's true by itself, there's no question about it. And if you are giving the GRE, then Barron's word list says that axiom is a self-evident truth which requires no proof. So, but the technical interpretation is pretty much different. So, let me talk about this. Oh, okay. So, what is an axiom? Axiom is, as Professor Raghunathan earlier pointed out, you can play your game any way you want. You define the rules of the game, which are precisely the axioms, and then the game follows. Right? So, axioms are not, there's nothing true in math. Given these axioms, you can say that these things are true. These axioms imply these things, but you cannot, there's no absolute truth. So I'd like to demonstrate this using the parallel line axiom in geometry. So it says that given a line and a point outside the line, there exists a unique line which passes through that point and is parallel to the given line. So anybody will say that, okay, fine, let me try to fit some line. There seems to be only one, so it is self-evidently true. So I'll call it to be true. But it can neither be proved nor disproved using the other axioms. So what would I call such a statement? I cannot call it true outrightly, but I don't want to call it self-evidently true. I want some rigor. So am I allowed to say that the statement is false without sounding illogical? So apparently you can. So if I assume the parallel line axiom as was stated, then you get what is called the Euclidean geometry, where there's only one line which is parallel to the given line. But if I say that, if I state my axiom like this, that there is no line passing through that point which is parallel to the given line, then this type of geometry, elliptic geometry, satisfies that such a geometry. And if I state my axiom like there can exist multiple lines passing through that point and parallel to the given line, then the hyperbolic geometry satisfies such a axiom. So what is the axiom of choice? It says that given a set of non-empty boxes, you can choose an element from each box. Do you have any questions on this? Yes, seriously, I'm asking. Would you call this obvious or self-evidently true? Anybody would be tempted to say such a thing. But let's see what's the fuss about the axiom. So if I'm given one box and I'm asked to choose an element from that box, can I do it? It's straightforward. I think yes, you can. Given one box, I can just take one element. Given a finite number of boxes, can you choose an element from each box? Here also it's sort of straightforward because I can just go to each box and take an element from each box. So that's straightforward. The problem comes here when there are infinite number of boxes. Can you choose an element from each box? So the problem here is that I cannot go to every box and take an element from each box. It's not practical. So you have to do something else to choose. Right? You cannot go to each box. So what is the math way of representing infinite number of objects? Yeah, any answers? You know it already. Maybe I have stated it in a very, very bad way. Yeah, sorry? Yeah, I think somebody said it. Sets. And how do you deal with them is functions. Oops, sorry. Yeah, so set is the way to deal with infinite objects, and functions are to sort of operate on them. So I can define, if I can define such a function f, which will, given a box, it will choose an element from that box. It will choose it for me. I don't have to go do it manually. It's, if I can construct such a choice function, then I can say that the axiom of choice is true, or that I can choose an element from each box if I can construct such a function. So let's take an example. So suppose I have boxes like these. So first box contains numbers 1 to 10, second box contains numbers 11 to 20, and so on. So can I choose? So there are infinite number of boxes. Can I choose an element from each box? So a sample choice function is, say I say 10 n minus n plus 3. So ultimately what I get out of each box is 3, 13, 23, and so on. So I have constructed a choice function for these, this particular example. Axiom of choice is general. It says that given any collection of boxes, it may be finite, countable, uncountable, or even larger. I mean, there are levels of infinity. So given any collection of non-empty boxes, you can choose an element from each box. So can you tell me what is the negation of axiom of choice? I mean, what does it mean to say that the axiom of choice is false? Right, it means that, it says that there exists a set for which there is no choice function. Right, you cannot choose an element from each box. I mean, you know, it sounds very weird. So let's say, so does there always exist a choice function? So this is one example, this one quote by Bertrand Russell, who says that if you are given a set of shoes, pair of shoes, you are given a set of pair of shoes, then you can choose a shoe from each pair, because I can define a choice function. I can say choose the left shoe, right? So I have defined that function, choice function. But in case of socks, I cannot do that. If I am given a pair of socks, I cannot say that choose the left sock, because there is no left sock. Okay, so what now? The Banach-Tarski's paradox says, we are back to the same picture, which is the first slide, which says that you can divide a sphere into finite many pieces and put it back together to get two spheres. So I mean, it sounds very counterintuitive at first. So why does it sound counterintuitive? Any guesses? Yeah, right. So the intuition part is that the volume has to be conserved, right? That is the intuition, because they are finite and I'm not stretching something, as since I'm not stretching, the volume has to be conserved. But what, why this is possible is that those pieces can have no volume. I mean, they can, they may be such that volume cannot be defined for such a thing. Now in maths, in mathematical language, it's called measure. So axiom of choice allows the construction of sets which, for which volume cannot be defined, you know, for which length cannot be defined. It's not possible. So there's no question of volume conservation, because you cannot define volume for those pieces. So that's the proof is out of scope. So anyway, so I'll come to this puzzle. You may have seen this puzzle before. It says there are 100 prisoners in a row, and each is made to wear a black or a white hat. And each, so they are all looking right way. I mean, it's not clear from the picture, but they are all looking towards the right. So each prisoner can look at all hats in front of him, but you cannot see your own hat and you cannot see the hats behind you. And start, so the game is this, that you start from the first prisoner and you ask him the color of his hat. He has to give an answer, he has to shout it aloud so everybody can hear the answer. And then if the guess is right, you release the prisoner, else you execute the prisoner. So the question is, the prisoners can sort of decide a strategy by which they want to save the maximum number. So do you know the answer to this puzzle? How many can you save? Yeah, what's it? Yeah, so you can save 99, right? So this is the solution. You say, you label the hats as 1 and 0. So for a black hat, you call it 1, and for a white, you call it 0. And the, what the last prisoner does, he adds up all those numbers in front of him. He can see 1 and 0, 1, 0, 1, 1. He can see a sequence, he adds all those numbers, and if the number is sum, if the sum is odd, then he guesses black. If the sum is even, he guesses white. Anyway, he had any 50% chance of, he has no way of guessing his own color, so that is left to chance. But the best part is that everybody else comes to know their color, their own color, because the last person says that, okay, the number of black hats in front of me is odd. The second person will see that, okay, the number of black hats in front of me is even. So he can conclude that his own hat color is black. So he can say black, and so on. So everybody else comes to know their hat color. This is true irrespective of what that sequence is. So their strategy saves 99 for sure. Right? So worst case is 99 and the best case is 100. So let's take a slight variation where each person is inside a glass box. Right? So you can see the colors in front of you, but you cannot, the whatever you say is not heard by anybody, right? So this is a slight modification. Now what can you do? How many can you save? Right? Now, by virtue of the glass box, you cannot pass on any information. There's no way of giving out any information. So apparently that does not seem to be any strategy. On an average, you will save 50. In the worst case, you will save 0. There's no, I mean, you cannot do anything. Let's take another modification, where there are countably infinite number of prisoners. So for every natural number, there is a prisoner. Right? And every prisoner is inside a glass box, so he can see all hats in front of him. But whatever he says cannot be heard by anybody. So this example was taken from this site, so it's not original, and with the solution, of course. Yeah. So in the average case, you lose infinite people, you lose everybody. Right? That's what we would expect. And there's no way of passing information. So in the average case, you will save half the people, but you lose half the people, which is still infinite. And the worst case, you lose everybody. So there's apparently no hope for the prisoners. But the axiom of choice comes to the rescue, which gives a solution where in the worst case, you lose at most finite number of people. Right? So this is what I'll prove. So there is somebody has said that any good math talk should have one proof and one joke, and they should not be the same. So I hope I hope that would be true in my case. Yeah, so before I give the proof for the give the strategy for the problem, I'll give an alternate view of the axiom of choice. Earlier I had said that given a set of non-empty boxes, you can choose an element from each box. Now I'm restating that, and I'm saying that given a set and a partition over that set, where each partition is non-empty, then I can choose an element from each partition. You can see that this is same as what I had said previously. The set can be infinite, the number of partitions can be infinite, and so on. So how to partition a set? So one way is ki I manually go and put these objects in one box, put the other these objects in another box, and so on. But there can be another way. The other way is to relate different objects. This happens in several fields. You try to sort of, in chemistry, you try to group elements according to properties. You say that these two have the same properties, so they are related. So I sort of relate objects and group them together. But the relation should be such that if one object A is related to object B, and object B is related to object C, then A and C should be related. So this is called transitivity, as you may be already knowing. So if I can find such a relation, then I can group related objects into one partition, and this naturally induces a partition over the set. So this is similar to what can be done in animal kingdom, say. I say that cat is similar to a tiger, and tiger is similar to something. So this, I mean, sort of divides the animal kingdom into families. Right, so now I present the solution to the infinite prisoners problem. So define S to be the set of all binary sequences. Binary sequences are those sequences of 1 and 0. And I call two sequences related if they are equal after a certain position. So there exists some position after which all of them are equal. So the first two sequences given, they are related because after that red line, they are all equal. So the tail of the sequence is equal. In the second one, I have chosen the two sequences such that for every one in the above sequence, there is a zero in the lower sequence. And every zero in the above sequence, there is a one in the lower sequence. So these two sequences cannot be related because there cannot be any position after which all of them are identical. So these are unrelated sequences. So this relation is transitive because, you know, if A is related to B and B is related to C, then I mean A and B are similar after a certain position. B and C are related after a certain position. So if I take maximum of the two, I can find a position where after which A and C are both equal. Right? So for sake of intuition, I didn't want to mislead people. I mean, I was assuming a larger crowd. So I didn't talk about symmetry and reflexivity. So I mean, you can see that is trivially true. So this partitions the set. So this is the solution. These three statements completely give the solution. So what the strategy involves is the prisoners meet and they take this. So you have a partition on the set of all binary sequences. They decide upon a choice from each partition. Right? You can choose an element from each partition by the axiom of choice. So I choose an element from each partition and they decide upon that, and everybody remembers that choice. Now, whenever a prisoner is standing, I can look at the sequence in front of me. So I can immediately find out which partition this sequence lies in. Right? Yeah, they are looking towards the right. I mean, they are smaller, so I thought it was clear, but apparently it's not. Yeah, they are looking towards the right. So when a person is standing, I can see everybody in front of me, so I can deduce which partition this given sequence lies in. So from that partition, I had chosen some sequence. So the prisoner will guess that color which he was wearing in that chosen sequence. I'll make it clear, sort of. Is it clear? I mean, is it okay? I'll make this point clear. See, there is a partition. When I look at the sequence in front of me, I get to know which partition this given current sequence lies in. Right? From that partition, we had earlier chosen an element. So suppose that were the current hat sequence. If that were the current hat sequence, then what would be my color? I would guess that color. So if whatever color is there in the current sequence, I don't care. I look at that sequence, which was the chosen sequence, and in that sequence, the color I was wearing, that would be my guess. Right? So the claim is that this guessing strategy will save infinite people. Let's see why. So suppose the first sequence was the chosen sequence from that partition, and the second one was the sequence that is actually there. So by that relation which was described earlier, you can see that they have to be same after a certain level. After a certain position, they have to be same. So every prisoner after a certain position will be saved. Right. So you save infinite people. Now what happens in the worst case? The person setting up the hats, even if he knows what their choice is, he can set up a malicious hat sequence, which will sort of, the number of people lost will be arbitrarily large, but he cannot make it infinite. Right? Whatever he does, he can choose any malicious sequence. It has to be related to that choice sequence. But after a certain position, all of them have to be saved. So in the worst case, you lose at most finite. Even if the jailer knows what their strategy is, what their choice is, even after that, the worst case is, the number of people lost in the worst case is still finite. So I'll like to conclude here. This is another quote. So maybe you're already aware about these three statements. The axiom of choice is like what as we described earlier, seems to be obviously true. There's another statement called the well-ordering principle. Do I have time? How much time do I have? 3 minutes, okay. Well-ordering principle, I'll just briefly state. It says that given any set, I can define an order on a set, right? I can define an order on the set such that any subset of that set will have a least element. Okay, maybe that's not, it's very vague. Take the case of natural numbers. If I take any subset of natural numbers, it has a smallest element, right? So this is called the well-ordering principle for natural numbers. So, but for reals, this is not true. If I take the open interval 0 to 1, it does not have a least element. But well-ordering principle says that you can reorder the reals such that take any subset of reals, it will have a smallest element. This is the statement of the well-ordering principle, which seems obviously false. I mean, it's very, very non-intuitive that such a thing can be true. And there is another statement called Zorn's lemma, which is fairly involved. So nobody can apply intuition on that statement. So the quote is that the axiom of choice is obviously true. The well-ordering principle is obviously false. And who knows about Zorn's lemma? So I guess that's all. Do you have any questions?